Good morning and welcome to our morning worship, which includes Holy Communion and is led by the Reverend Neil Thorogood. There will be a retiring collection for the Jesse May Trust. If this is the first time worshipping with us, welcome. Please make yourself known and join us for refreshments after the service. The readers this week are Jean Isaacs and Sandra Inglis. It is with great sadness that I have to inform you of the death of Mal Owen last Tuesday. Mal was a long-standing active member of our church community. Along with his great sense of humour, he was supportive and would offer help where possible. Our prayers and thoughts are with Janet and family and friends. The funeral of Jean Lambert takes place on Thursday, the 11th of April at 12:45 in church. This will be followed by a service of committal at the Westerly Crematorium. The funeral of Gordon Holmes will take place on Friday, the 3rd of May, with a service at Camford at 12 noon for close family and friends. This will be followed by a service of thanksgiving for Gordon's life. Refreshments will be available following this. Advance notices. On the 27th of April, I'm coordinating a one-day performance, a choir of people from all over are going to meet together to sing a song of compassion and peace with a backing band. I'm going to teach the song over an hour. It is wondrous and it's going to be a joyful occasion. If you're considering going, please do. Flyers are at the back of the church, but if you know someone else that you think might be interested, please take one, get the word out. Time is running out, but there's no closing date for applications. It's just a phone call to the office. Please get involved. Notices for the week. The usual church activities take place on Tuesday and Friday. Everyone is welcome. At these times, the church is open for private prayer and reflection. On Tuesday, the elders meet in the coffee bar at 7:30 p.m. On Thursday, from 10 a.m. to 12 noon, the art group meets in the Leonard Hall. At 2 p.m., also in the Leonard Hall, the Guild meets. The subject is Wind in the Willows by Tim Lewis and Sheila Furness. At 7:30 p.m., at the manse, a faith-related discussion group will take place. All are welcome. Just come on the night. On Friday, from 12 p.m. to 2 p.m., there's a craft lunch in the coffee bar. All are welcome, and you do not have to craft to come. Sounds like a social get-together, doesn't it? Next Sunday, the 14th of April, the service is led by Hazel Trapnell. Hazel has led services before, and it will be a pleasure to welcome her back. Please stand for the Bible.
Would you like to come and light our candle? That's great. Thank you. So the candle burns. The light shines. And we hear words from the first letter of John. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And so, as part of the great family around the world, it called together in worship today, we join to sing our opening hymn. If you're using the hymn book, it's number 238. Good Christians all, rejoice and sing. Be seated. We come to God in prayer. Let us pray. Dear God, on this new day that you have made, we thank you for the gift of it and the gift of one another to share it. And we thank you for all of those with whom we share this day in different ways, at different times. We thank you for those joining with us in worship from other places, and we thank you that we can be a family united together even if we are not able to physically be here. We take a moment in the stillness of our own hearts to think back over the week that has gone by. Perhaps to home in on something that has brought us particular blessing this week. Maybe a conversation or an encounter or something seen or read or understood. And in our own hearts, let us give thanks. Gracious God, as we thank you in our different ways with the different things in our lives, so we also come to confess. We recognize that all is not well. We know that we are part of a world that so often is turned in upon itself and turned against itself. We know that in so many ways, violence and injustice and cruelty do their evil work. And we know that in our lives, there are times, places, and situations where we were not all we could be, where we were not all that you would want us to be. And some of these times linger for us. We carry them as burdens. They continue to weigh us down with their shame and their heartache. And we come to worship, dear God. And we come into a place of prayer, but that is also a place of forgiveness. For you have revealed yourself. In Jesus, you have taken all that destroys and you have carried it away, that our sins might be forgiven and that we might know we are forgiven and live as your forgiven people. Help us to know that to be true today, and help us to live in the light of your grace. In Christ's name, amen. And we join together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. I want to invite us to think a little bit about books and films this morning. And the book and the film that I want to invite you to think about is called The Shawshank Redemption. Now then, can I just, this is where the moment at which this entire thing goes horribly wrong. Can I just have a quick show of hands as to anyone who has read or seen The Shawshank Redemption? Okay, a good, goodly number. So, there's quite a lot going on in it, so the good news is I'm not going to tell you anything much about what goes on in it. It's just, and I'm also, now that I know that not everyone has read it or seen it, I'm going to be very, very careful not to spoil it for you by talking too much about the ending. But there is something very interesting about the ending. When Stephen King wrote the book, the ending does not tell you what happens next. When they turned the book into a film, they didn't like that idea, because they said film audiences like to have a story that has a proper ending. So when you watch the film, they've added an extra bit to the ending to make it all come together. And that's interesting. And I don't want to get into a huge debate about why that was done and so on, but what's interesting is that when Stephen King wrote the book, he wanted you to close the book and wonder, what happens next? And some of the greatest stories that I think we tell are stories in which, at the end, there is another chapter that we don't know about. And we come on what is described as Low Sunday today. Easter Sunday is the greatest Sunday of the Christian calendar. The Sunday after Easter traditionally was known as Low Sunday, not because everyone arrived in church feeling low, necessarily, not because everyone had gone away on holiday so no one ever came to church, but because compared to Easter Sunday, it couldn't be quite as significant. But the thing about great stories, like the Shawshank Redemption, is that they leave us knowing that there is more to come. There is another bit to the story. And I wonder if today, as we listen to what we will hear soon in the Bible, and as we come again to the communion table, I wonder if one of the things that we're doing is we're entering into an unfinished story. Easter has been and gone, but Easter is the greatest unfinished story of them all. And we are here today, and every church is wherever it is today, because the story is not yet finished. And we'll be thinking perhaps a bit about that as we journey on. I think in a moment some of our friends will be heading off to do their own thing, so I'm just going to offer a prayer for them, and then we're going to sing together. But let us pray. Dear God, as we worship in different places, as we go to a different part of this building, but also as some of us join in worship online, thank you that we are all still part of your family, and that we are part of the community that gathers in your name through Jesus Christ. Amen. And so we turn in the hymn books, if we are using them, to number 412, 412. There's a quiet understanding. Please be seated as we turn to our readings from the Bible.
The first reading is from Acts chapter 4, verses 32 to 35, and you'll find it on page 118 of your Bibles. The believers share their possessions. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold, and they laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. Thanks be to God.
Second reading is from the first chapter of 1 John and then verses 1 and 2 of chapter 2. This can be found on page 236 of the New Testament. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testify to it and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard so that you may also have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, and he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Here ends the reading. Thanks be to God for his holy word.
Thank you. In the hymn books, we turn to number 377, 377. This is the day.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord our God. Amen. What gets left behind after Easter? The chocolate eggs begin to come to an end, perhaps, unless you have overordered. The flowers may begin to wilt a little. One more hot cross bun may feel to be one hot cross bun too many, although maybe you can never have too many hot cross buns. The Easter cards and the Easter trees might be put away, and spring is here and the birds are singing and they are nesting, and we hope fervently that perhaps the rain will stop a little so that we can get out and the sun will shine and it will feel a bit warmer, and Easter is over and the world moves on. And what gets left behind? Our readings this morning from the New Testament invite us to notice what Easter leaves behind for creation, for God, for me, and for you. And we get a few snapshots of the start of things. The life and death and the resurrection of Jesus are creating an astonishing newness. It ripples from the cross and the empty tomb, and it runs on and on and on, and it alters reality. It changes the world. Easter leaves behind transformation. And we're gathered here today, even the idea of being in church here today bear witness to the ways in which Easter keeps on going, refuses to come to an end, keeps on changing things, creating newness and possibility and wonder. And perhaps our readings this morning are inviting us just a little more into the newness and the possibility and the wonder of Easter. And maybe we could see how Acts and 1 John show us what comes next for creation and for God and for me and you. The book of Acts begins to tell our story, because it begins to tell the story of the church. And something is shifting and something is being born. The Romans put to death a wandering rabbi whose friends and followers scattered and hid. Another strange Jewish holy man and potential revolutionary had been dealt with. It was the end of the story. Everyone could just carry on, and he would be forgotten. And for his friends, any idea that he might have been God's chosen one, the Messiah, the Savior of creation, dies when he breathes his last breath on a cross. And friends, I wonder if we are so used to what happens next that it is very, very hard for us to appreciate the enormity of what happens next. Easter is such a familiar story. And maybe every now and then it's good for us to try and imagine the revolution that walked out of the tomb. Jesus, risen from the dead, returns to visit his friends. They meet him, they talk with him, they eat and they drink with him, they find him entering into their lives and entering into their buildings in different places. And he isn't a ghost, and he isn't a figment of overheated imaginations. They can touch him, and his body carries the wounds that the cross gave him. They are amazed. But his resurrection appearances come to an end. He said they would. He said there would come a moment when he would return to his Father and our Father, and they would see him no more. But that return doesn't for a moment end what Jesus is doing. It just changes what Jesus is doing. And we get a glimpse of that change as we turn to the very end of that part of the first letter of John. We get a hint of how Jesus keeps on doing what he has always been doing. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. In a few weeks' time, the church will celebrate the Day of Ascension. And we'll remember the story the Bible tells of Jesus leaving his friends for this final time and bringing down the curtain on his resurrection appearances. But he does not go away to forget about us. He doesn't go away to leave us bereft and alone. The resurrection has work and wonder still to bring, and Jesus is at the heart of it still. If you read the first letter of John, as we have read the opening of it, I think it would be fair to say that you are going to find yourself in some pretty deep theology, which is fabulous. And we could spend an awesome number of happy hours trying to understand what is being talked about. And an awful lot of ink has been spilled over an awful lot of books exploring this mystery of what happens when the Son of God returns to the Father, and what does that mean? So the good news today is that you don't need to worry about me trying to do that. My invitation to you would be, in your own time, read this amazing letter. And then, I hope, another time, we might take time to read it together and wonder at what it's telling us. But for now, for this moment, I just want to invite us to notice one thing. Jesus is beginning a new era in his own ministry. He has come to show us and all creation the way to God. And now he carries that work on within the very heart and being of God. He becomes our advocate, the one who speaks on our behalf, the companion who knows us through and through, and who brings everything that we are into the life and heart of God. And he knows us so well. He knows me so well. He knows that things can go wrong for us. in our lives, certainly in my life, sin comes visiting. I don't manage to do the good that I want to do, even when I know what that is. There are words spoken aloud or marshaled in my mind that are weapons to hurt other people. There is a lack of understanding and a lack of willingness to understand all that might be hurting someone else. There are regrets that loiter in the secret places in my soul. And there is brokenness in me, and there is shame in me. And maybe, for you too. And all of this Jesus knows. All of this Jesus sees. And all of this Jesus holds within the heart and being of God. Forgiveness, asking for it, feeling it, is never a once and single moment. There may be special moments. There may be times when we have a particularly close sense of the presence of God and the love of God and the forgiveness of God. And there may be times when we really do manage to discover how to forgive ourselves and how to really mean it when we pray the prayer we've already prayed. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Forgiveness, I think, is an ongoing journey. It is a lifelong journey of being forgiven, of forgiving ourselves, and of forgiving others. And all our life long, Jesus is making that journey with us and for us in the heart of heaven. I only know a tiny fraction of your stories. You only know a tiny fraction of mine. And if you're joining us online, we may even have never met. Whatever your story, wherever you are, whoever you are, the great gift of Easter is listening to the voice of Jesus that celebrates you, cherishes you, restores you, forgives you, and loves you so completely that not even death will separate you from the love of God. All this is what Easter leaves behind. All this is what we will find as we come later to this table to share bread and wine. And we will remember that Jesus gives himself that we might know ourselves and know ourselves to be forgiven, to be loved, to be worth it in every way. And that brings us, perhaps just for a moment, to the book of Acts. And Acts tells the story of how those who believe all of this begin to live. The Romans thought that everything had ended when a dead body was taken down and hastily placed in a borrowed tomb. And then it turns out, if you look at the beginning of the fourth chapter of Acts, that something like 4,000 people are starting to celebrate that Jesus is risen from the dead, that he is the Savior, he is the one who carries us into the heart of God. and they start to live in the light of that. And it changes how they live. One of the great theologians of more recent years is also perhaps the most famous ever member of the United Reformed Church, and that was Leslie Newbegin. And Leslie had a favorite phrase: the most compelling evidence for the truth of the gospel is a community of people who live it. After Easter comes the church. After Easter, we come. And we see in Acts how they begin to live in a different way. They share the story of what they have found. They don't write enormous books of theology. They simply say what they have found. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. They, from their very different lives, become a community of different people who begin to share together. The whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul. And they share generously with one another. No one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. If you read on in the book of Acts, you will discover that actually living with one heart and soul is pretty tricky, and they often don't manage to do it. Because, of course, the church is made up of broken, fallible, ordinary people like me and you. And we get it wrong. Churches have got it wrong in all sorts of ways. But as we continue the journey of Easter as a congregation here, we are continuing a journey of thinking about our future. And these little pictures in Acts might be saying something to us about creating a community here that is open to everyone, and where everyone is cherished and every gift is held and treasured. And a community of ridiculous generosity. A giving place. A receiving place. And I want to end by just taking you for a moment into the week that I have had. And I want to take you to Tuesday. And I got a message very early Tuesday morning from one of Mal Owen's sons to say, "We think that Dad will not be with us much longer. Could you come?" And so I went to the home, and there was Mal in bed, and one of his sons who had been keeping watch over the night. And as I went in, I said hello, and Mal opened his eyes, and those of us who knew Mal will remember his smile. And his smile just lit up the room. And I sat with him, and I think I did most of the talking. But every now and then, Mal would mouth an answer and a thought. And we prayed. And we shared in the Lord's Prayer. And as we were doing that, a nurse came in and she gave Mal a couple of injections to ease his pain. And I went off to begin the rest of the day promising to return. And about an hour later, got the message to say that Mal had died. And this is where it counts. Is Easter true? Is this church real? Is faith worth it? Does it matter? Yes, it does. Mal showed me just how much. As has Gordon, as has Jean. We will have 3 funerals in this church for dearly beloved friends. They have taught us something of how the story of Easter never ends. May they all rest in peace and rise in glory. And may this church be a beacon for the whole world. Amen. Let's take a moment for our own thoughts and for the music. Join to sing together number 564 in the hymn book, Jesus, Lord, we look to thee.
Jesus, Lord, we look to thee.
Let us pray. Dear God, as we bring our gifts of money and bread and wine, may we also offer you again our very lives, that you might take these gifts we bring and use them for your work. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. So, friends, we come again to share in the bread and wine. Please be seated. And we remember the words of the Apostle Paul as the church began to learn what this might be. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks and praise for the wonders of your creation and for the gift of life and the gift of life shared amongst us. We give you thanks that you so loved the world, that you came amongst us in Jesus of Nazareth, living our life, sharing our joys, entering into our suffering, carrying yourself even into our dying, and rising again, to reveal to us the wonder and the joy of the peace that you alone can give, the peace that welcomes us home, the peace that tends our broken hearts, the peace that builds us together into the body of Christ. Send now your Holy Spirit to bless us and this bread and wine, that these gifts might be for us the body and blood of Jesus Christ, and that as we eat and drink, we might be united with all your people around us in this place, joining us in other places, and all your people on earth and in heaven. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. We'll remain seated, and the bread and the wine will be brought to you where you are. The wine is non-alcoholic, and on each plate there is also a piece of gluten-free bread, if that is for you. And so we remember how on that night our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks to God, broke it, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you." the body of Christ broken for us. After supper, Jesus took the cup, blessed it, shared it, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in memory of me." Blood of Christ shed for us. Please be seated. We come to God in prayer. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for all you have shared of yourself here. Now we share our prayers for others and our prayers for ourselves. We think of a world that in so many ways is aching with violence and terror, with injustice, with uncertainty, with the pressures that weigh people and communities down. And we take a moment to think of some of these places and some of these people who are on our hearts today. And we offer them into your care. as we remember Gordon and Jean and Mal. We remember others who have died. We pray for all who mourn. We pray for all who are sick in body, mind, or spirit, and everyone who in any way is caring for another. And again, we take a moment to bring to you the people on our hearts. And as Easter continues to unfold, we pray for ourselves. We pray that something of the story begun with an empty tomb might be written in our hearts and in our daily living. So we pray for ourselves. We pray for those sitting around us. And we pray that your love and your mercy and your blessing might be for us. Lord of life, all these prayers we offer, the ones we speak aloud, the ones we know in our hearts, the ones we have not yet even formed. We pray that you hear us, and we pray for all those we have remembered. In Jesus' name, amen. We join to sing together a final hymn this morning. In the hymn book sits number 243, Now the Green Blade Rises.
Thank you.
blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the Creator, the Saviour and Sustainer, be with us and all creation, today and forever. Amen.